This week, we welcome Ashley Rose, CEO at Living Security, to discuss where is the human in your risk management program. In the leadership and communication section, only 1 in 10 CISOs today are board ready. Why conflicting ideas can make your strategy stronger, how to overcome communication barriers in your teamwork, and more. Business Security Weekly starts now.
This is a Security Weekly production for security professionals by security professionals. Please visit securityweekly.com/subscribe to subscribe to all the shows on our network. Broadcasting live from G-Unit Studios in Rhode Island, it's the show where we explore the business of security to improve the security of business. Your trusted source for actionable insights on leadership, communication, and innovation. Get ready for Business Security Weekly.
How do you win the race against risk and safely lock down your cloud data without hiring an army of administrators? Introducing Least Privilege Automation, only from Varonis. Varonis eliminates data exposures while your employees work and while they sleep, making intelligent decisions about who needs access to data and who doesn't. Our cloud-native solution analyzes permissions and sharing links, monitors access activity, and classifies sensitive data. Because Varonis knows who can and who does access critical data, our automation safely remediates risky links and permissions. Learn more at securityweekly.com/Varonis. Welcome to Business Security Weekly. This is episode number 309, recorded June 12th, 2023. I am your host, Matt Alderman. Joining me for this lovely segment, first, we're going to start with Jason Albuquerque. He's in studio.
In studio again today, Matt. I'm liking this habit that I'm making here. Getting me out of the home office.
I love it, because we've got this beautiful studio in Rhode Island. Not that many people get to go in there.
That's
so
right. We have to use somebody. But I had a weekend full of kiddo soccer games and tournaments. So it's that end of year action going on with the kids.
Yes, the summer begins. Also joining remotely for this segment, Mr. Ben Carr. Welcome, Ben.
Hey, Matt. How's it going? Did a little barbecuing yesterday. Got outside. Nice weather. A little warm. But yeah. Finally starting to get the barbecue on.
Yeah, you get the heat during the day. We've been getting rain in the evening. I don't know if you guys down in Austin are, but we've had rain the last couple of nights. It cools it down beautifully, and then it gets hot again.
Yeah, it was a little windy. We didn't have a ton of rain, but just a little bit of every now and then we'll get a little bit. But yeah, it has been raining a lot more than normal. So, but yeah, the afternoons, evenings have been really nice.
Texas weather. And last but not least, Mr. Tyler Robinson, are you rainy in Idaho or are you dry?
I don't know. I think the weather's still a little bit drunk from winter here, you know, seventh winter. Anyway, we've had a lot of rain, but it's been very warm. So it kind of changes its mind hourly.
Yeah, I know Colorado's been getting a ton of rain, which is kind of odd. Or it's usually so dry. I didn't know if Idaho was getting some of that same weather or not.
Very much, very much.
Join our Discord channel to chat with our hosts, ask questions, customize live stream alerts, and more. Visit securityweekly.com/Discord to receive an invite. This segment is sponsored by Living Security. To learn more, please visit securityweekly.com/Living Security. As the CEO and co-founder of Living Security, Ashley Rose is the driving force behind Living Security's push to lead the human risk management industry. She has successfully raised more than $25 million in funding to scale the business, pivoted the company from solely in-person training to a fully digital platform, and has led the company to be named an industry leader in the Forrester Wave. She co-founded Living Security based on the philosophy that empowering people is the best approach to lasting security behavior changes and breach prevention. Ashley, welcome to Business Security Weekly.
Thanks, Matt. It's great to be here.
So full disclosure, Ashley's my boss, so I got to watch myself today. No, not really. So Ashley, as we were preparing for this interview segment, I was doing a little research, right? Where is the human in your risk management program? But I started looking around. I'm like, what happened to like all the risk management like magic quadrants? Like, the GRC space evolved into integrated risk management. Both have been retired by Gartner. The IT vendor risk, the IT risk management, like the market on the risk management side is evolving, and yet we still are challenged with the human side. Like, what the heck's going on? Like, where's my risk management program guidance?
Yeah, I think about this often. I think Gartner, you know, and I'm a fan, right? And we would love to work with them, but it feels like they're a little bit caught in the middle right now, right? We're a little late to the party of developing what I think needs to become the human risk management quadrant, right? A couple of years ago, they moved the security awareness and training magic quadrant down to a market guide. And then now it seems like we're, you know, as you said, we're taking insider risk management and some of these others, the GRCs, integrated risk management, offline potentially a little too early. Even just doing a little bit of, you know, outside research, you know, in the insider risk management space, you know, we're seeing other content that's talking about its growth from a $2.2 billion market in 2022 to a $7.2 by 2023. So it's just, it's growing like crazy, but yet we're not going to cover it anymore. I don't really know what's going on specifically there behind the scenes, but it's certainly an interesting perspective that they have right now.
Yeah, we've seen Forrester kind of make the move from security awareness and training to human risk management. That's what they're going to call it, and into the category that we play in. But when I even looked at Gartner Security and Risk, which was the conference you were at last week, right? I didn't see a lot of human-related risk topics on the agenda. I saw a lot still around tooling and different solutions and those sorts of things. And I was like, I was hoping I would see more human-related content at the conference, but I think there were only like one or two sessions that really kind of focused on the human element.
Yeah, so, I mean, it was a pretty large conference. I would say if you went to the cybersecurity leadership track, maybe 30-40% of those sessions within the cybersecurity leadership track actually did have a focus on human. There was a huge emphasis on culture, and that was to be expected given, you know, Gartner's, you know, what they are now calling their security behavior and culture program, which I think we can dig a little bit deeper here in a couple minutes. But so huge focus on culture. We talked a lot about, you know, psychometrics. We talked about insider threat. We talked about insider risk. And then, you know, of course, we're still really focused on the talent side. But I think the talent and the culture ultimately work together. So you know, I think given the, you know, how well-rounded that conference is, having the cyber leadership piece very focused on culture also shows the elevated role of the conversation within organizations, right? These are conversations that are happening at the CISO's table, you know, within our, you know, our CRO's table, our chief risk officer, you know, and maybe potentially all the way up and hopefully to our CEO. So, I think that it was well placed. It may not have been, you know, widespread across the conference, but it was definitely targeting the right individuals that care and need to, you know, take action in getting their human risk reduction under control.
Ashley, how many of those sessions had to do with influence throughout the organization, right? Because at the end of the day, we need to be able to influence the other business unit leaders within our business, right? In order for us to make any type of headway, we need buy-in and support across the entire business from all the leaders. So influence is key. And for me, the only way to take the mentality out of this is cyber awareness training, check in the box compliance is to influence those business leaders so that way they can influence downstream within their organization. Were any of those sessions educating on how to build relationships, build trust, start embedding it in the DNA of the entirety of the business, not just cybersecurity or risk?
And I'm going to sound like a little bit of a, this is all very Gartner focused. I don't work for Gartner, obviously, but do follow them quite a bit and have been able to influence the way that they talk about this market and specifically our category. And so, you know, one of the things that Gartner came out with some of the research is what they describe as their PIPE framework. And PIPE stands for practices, influences, platforms, and enablers. And so exactly what you said, we have to be able to influence the culture of the organization, right? We think about the program itself is the what. And they think about that as security behavior and culture programs. We call it human risk management. But the PIPE framework, the influencers, the enablers, that's the how. How do we actually operationalize, you know, the program across the business? And so the enablers specifically talks a lot about executive support, you know, really having like an engaging vision, And that's the, why does this matter? You know, I think another interesting data point that was shared was that by 2026, there's an expectation that half of C-level executives will have performance requirements related to cybersecurity risk built into their employment contracts. So if you think about then the why, like, why does this matter? Why should you care? Well, you're going to actually start seeing personal impact in your compensation strategy based on how well you are managing and mitigating cybersecurity risk. So yeah, there absolutely was that. I think one of the keynotes was also how to get people to care, and people meaning executives, right, all the way down to, you know, every single individual employee. And we certainly, you know, subscribe to that idea as well, that security is, you know, everyone's responsibility. It may not be everyone's job, but it certainly everyone has a responsibility.
So a follow up then. I mean, you mentioned that in the future, half of executives will have some type of KPI around cybersecurity. You know, in us cybersecurity professionals, we always talk about how can you protect if you don't know you have it, right? So knowing your assets, you can't protect things you don't know you have. How can we be helping our fellow executives to identify risk at the human level within their department? Because as security professionals, we're not going to be able to do that. We don't know the nuances of their department, the nuances of their portion of the business to that level. But how can we be guiding other executives to identify risk within their organization from a human perspective?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, there's a few angles there. So one, I would say that, you know, given some of the newer technologies, like the platform piece, right, of that pipe framework, there are more ways now, more than ever, that, and they did not necessarily exist before, for security teams to be able to provide that visibility to their business leaders. And so I would actually say that, you know, a good chunk of that responsibility still lies in security to be able to uncover data, you know, tap into their systems and be able to pull out those behavioral metrics, those indicators of, you know, what's causing risk to the business. I think what you're talking about, which is the business's responsibility, is the context piece. Mm-hmm. And so what may be construed as risky behavior for one organization or even one department in an organization, like, you know, let's, a random one would be, you know, browsing certain websites, certain web behavior, right? There may be certain roles in an organization where that's absolutely necessary to get your job done. And the security team may not have that context. And so what we need to do is we need to have sort of a shared, we need to have a shared dashboard in a sense, or, you know, at least somewhere to kind of baseline the conversation. So security comes to the table with metrics that say, you know, here are the things that we see that we think could be potentially risky to our organization, and here's why. And then the business says, well, actually, you know, this one is necessary to get my job done. And so if we need to do that, but it's causing risk, how can we actually work together to think about, you know, putting, like, creating a safer environment for my employee mm-hmm. to function, right? Or, you know, maybe vice versa, where the business actually says, oh, I didn't realize that was causing risk to the business. I don't need this type of permission, this type of access. This can be stripped away, or is there a tool that can help us with this? I think the more data that we can provide, the better the conversation gets. And now we're not arguing about each of us trying to get our way. You know, we all have the same goal in mind. We want to further the company's growth plans, right? We want to go earn more market share, or, you know, whatever it is, we want to increase our profitability. How we come to the table and have those conversations, that's where that data is absolutely required. And it can create a much more engaging and, you know, fruitful conversation, productive conversation.
Yeah, and that's exactly it. The example I always use is you could have, you know, a clerk on an admin team, right? And on its surface, the security team would say, yeah, not a huge threat, right? But little do you know is that person has fiduciary responsibility and privilege for the CEO, right? Where they're doing some level of finance or purchasing or something like that for the CEO. And it's that business unit that can give you that further intel to drive that, you know, that assessment of risk.
Yeah. And I think the same has to go, you know, other angles or other aspects of the human, right? So we think about, you know, specifically within our company and the work that we do, right, where we're providing a lot of risk quantification based on those data points that we discussed being pulled in from systems. And now we're getting more and more customers saying, well, how do I add in, you know, information for my HR system? Right. So now we're starting to cross the line to, you know, some insider threat type work or insider just risk management in general. But it all it really all, you know, comes together. So if you have someone that's taking certain actions and, you know, we know they're on a performance plan, that's potentially, you know, going to be more risky or could be indicative of some additional type of, you know, malicious risk for the business. You know, otherwise it may just be construed as, you know, normal business operations. So I think, you know, humans are messy, right? It's a little bit, it's not black and white, ones and zeros, as, you know, some other parts of our security program are. But I think with the right context, the right conversation, and the right people at the table, we can absolutely influence and, you know, have a program that's helpful to the business versus just trying to check a compliance box.
How do you bring about that conversation to your users, where you continue that building of trust and that culture around security without also having them be wary of, you know, oversight or spying, kind of keeping that intention at the right forefront so that everybody's moving in the right direction, those discussions are happening, and it's getting disseminated properly with the proper optics. Maybe that doesn't come down the best from all leaders. And so how do you kind of get that engagement with the end user so that they understand the purpose of the risk and the metrics and the measurements?
Yeah, great question. So a few parts that I'll touch on here. So one, you know, let's be honest with our users. This data is being collected today, right? We're not like adding, and specifically, you know, like our tool or any of the competitive tools on the market, as we think about like security behavior and culture programs, or human risk management programs. These tools are taking data that already exists in our systems that are already being collected, and they're just giving it a different view. So there's no, you know, additional oversight, you know, to your point earlier. And I think that that's probably a conversation that does need to be had. It's like in the back end of, you know, your intake forms, you know, when you're onboarding to companies, by the way, you know, we do monitor your endpoint and your computer and all these other things. So that's the first piece. But the second piece is then, you know, how do you use the data, right? And so, you know, if we're going to take that data and we're going to start putting, you know, consequences, you know, on the users for doing certain things that could potentially lead to, you know, termination or whatnot, whatever, to your point, there's going to be a lot of pushback. But, you know, when you have a program that's built for, you know, risk mitigation and to build a culture, right? That's why the culture piece is so important. Our goal is actually to help our people. Right. So how do we help our people? That's really the question here. You know, that we need to make sure that, you know, we're leading with empathy. And so let's say that our system does trigger something that happens and, you know, a user is sharing data, you know, outside of the organization. Okay. We get a trigger on that. You know, is our first thought, oh, that person is maliciously trying to share data and steal something from the company? Well, it's absolutely possible, but we're not going to go to our employee and come and confront them in that way. We need to go asking questions. You know, hey, we saw that this, you know, file was shared externally. You know, what's going on? Or, you know, hey, our policy is to be able to share data in this way, right? Just ask them those questions and figure out, like, are they trying to do their job and they were blocked and so they went around it? Or, you know, what was the purpose behind it and how can we help? You know, I think more often than not, a lot of times in those circumstances, these are, you know, either non-malicious, or, you know, non-malicious, or they're intentional and non-malicious, to my point earlier, which is I needed a way to get my job done. I didn't know how to do it. And so I did it. So that was not right. And I knew that. So still intentional, but, you know, I'm not trying to harm the company. So non-malicious. And in those cases, that's when we need to start engaging with education and training. We need to think about, you know, what types of systems and controls that we have in place. But so empathy is really critical there. And then I would say another piece would be give them the data, right? We talked about influence in creating that, you know, somewhat feedback loop to our managers and to our leadership, but why not our employees? So if we're going to trust an employee to come into our organization and to work to help, you know, accelerate our mission, do we not trust them to want to potentially do the right thing? And so I think if we can give that data to our people and say, you know, hey, here's the things that you're doing really well, here are opportunities to improve, we can actually then motivate and inspire them to take the right actions, whether that's, you know, go install MFA, start using a password manager, you know, take additional optional training or learn about these policies. So, you know, lead with empathy and then also create that feedback loop and motivate and inspire your people to do the right thing.
So Ashley, I want to dive into, I think you kind of referenced a little bit of this earlier, but I want to kind of dive into it a little more finely pointed. So, you know, I'm a big believer in the fact that I think the human side of security, and when you look at why we have issues, it usually tracks back to something that's it's something that's human, right? It's a lot of times it's not necessarily a flaw in the system. It's somebody did something not necessarily malicious, as you say. They did it because they weren't trained well. They didn't do something. But you know, when we track it back that way, it seems like there's a lack of interest in devoting the capital and energy into fixing those problems. And we treat it more, I think we've talked about it on the show a lot, is that security is treated as a technical problem, right? People come from a technical track traditionally. It's, you know, ones and zeros. It's often misunderstood. And so, you know, the rest of the organization thinks there's a technical solution when often it's a culture and a human problem that we need to solve first and then apply a technology maybe over top of that to solve it. So how do we spin that? How do we change that? How do we get organizations to realize that it really is a human problem? And we solve that first, we change that culture. And then on the back side of that, I think the other issue that we face, maybe you can talk to this some too, is that I think most companies are they want to trust their employees, right? And a lot of people they're essentially making mistakes, and we do have those malicious users internally that they do exist. But how do we get people to, one, make that transition to human culture change, but at the same time understand that we actually have to address that elephant in the room of, you know, we really can't trust everybody to do the right thing all the time, whether it is malicious or whether it is unintentional. So that's maybe a big topic to talk about, but that's that's my thought. When I hear you talk about this, that's where I hear a lot of this go.
Yeah, I think we should start with understanding and talking about why they're not investing more now, or why some are not investing more now. And so I have some data points to share. So I think first, you know, if you ask most CISOs, they are going to say they do want to change behavior and they want to reduce risk. So let's start there. Like, you know, our intentions are aligned. We want to reduce risk. We need to change human behavior. You know, people are still causing, you know, the latest DBIR report, over 70% of breaches point back to human error, right? So then we look down and we say, all right, well, what's current landscape look like? 90% of, you know, cybersecurity functions or organizations have an awareness program, but 69% of employees are admitting to intentionally bypassing security guidance. That's another Gartner stat. And so then, you know, more data, more stats, you know, without measures of success. So, you know, 84% of teams have a goal to change behavior, but then 40% are not actually consistently measuring behavior change. So, right, again, complete disconnect. We want to change behavior, you know, but our people are intentionally bypassing our controls. And also we're not measuring the results of our program. That's leading to exactly what you said, which is there's a huge hesitancy. There's almost like a disillusionment, right? That over the last decade, we've spent money on these awareness and training programs, but there's no metrics of success. And so we're not getting staff. We're not getting budget. We don't want to invest more. And so if that's where we are, you know, we need to start again at the bottom and we need to start building back up. And so this is where, you know, Living Security came in and, you know, some others in the industry. And we said, no, look, like there is actually a way to start measuring the impact of your program. There is data available. We can start monitoring this. And if we have the data, or you can't manage what you can't measure. If we have the data, we can start there. We can create that visibility. And then we can start taking more targeted and prescriptive action to actually make change. And then we can measure the results. And so if we, you know, work from top down of what I just said is, you know, we want to do it, you know, we're not maybe doing the right things, but we also don't have the data. We can build back up. Let's get the data so we can make better decisions. And how do we manage our program? What pieces of technology are we focusing on? How are we training? How are we educating? You know, then we can actually prove the results, and then that will create that flywheel of more investment. And so we're very much in the sort of emergence of this new category that, you know, that exact explanation is what we think about as human risk management. We're in the emergence of that. And so, you know, how do we do that? Like, how do we get more leaders to, you know, understand that there's a better way and want to put money behind it? Well, we have to prove that out. And so, you know, working with, you know, the work that we do with the analysts, talk to them about, you know, hey, there's a new solution available, you know, working with early adopters and transformational CISOs that believe that there's a better way. And, you know, they want to partner with vendors in the market to invest and create this type of solution. You know, once you have that going, you know, more organizations are going to look and say, oh, wow, it's working over here. This is a new solution. There is a way to actually accomplish my goals. Let's put money behind it. And then just to wrap this up with another stat, you know, I think today we're still at, let's call it 10 to 15% market adoption of, you know, what we think about as the human risk management program. But by 2030, the analysts are saying that we're going to be at 80%. So you can imagine in about 6.5 years, seven years or so, we're going to move from a highly disproportionate amount of organizations, you know, really still focused on compliance, to everyone running this data-driven risk management program when it comes to the human. That's a really exciting thing for me. It's a really exciting time for our market. And it should be exciting for all security leaders out there, because that means that your number one risk, we actually are going to be able to bring a solution that's going to help, you know, mitigate that and help reduce that and, you know, save you money and create a stronger culture for your business.
How does a company or organization that is just trying to get a handle on, we'll call it the fundamentals of security, or we'll call it the 80% of the organizations that are still trying to understand how to do cybersecurity correctly and getting that adoption set up, what does the conversation look like, and how do they begin to put this on their roadmap for the future and begin to adopt this as a priority for the next 3-year roadmap?
Yeah, these are conversations we're having all the time. You know, first step is educating and letting them know this exists. Hey, you know, we're like, yes, we're going to help you meet compliance, but there's more. And most of the time, you know, as we talk about, you know, what other parts of your business are run without metrics, right? What other parts of your business are, you know, just, you know, kind of ad hoc spray and pray. And really, there's not a lot, right? We've spent a lot of time and money and energy, you know, really driving a lot of efficiency within our marketing programs. Like, we know who to market, what to say, and what's working. And so if we think about, right, that aspect of it, you know, we're just applying data and intelligence like we would any other part of the business to now our human risk piece. And once they can see that there's a pretty simple way of getting that visibility into what's going on in their environment, you know, what people are doing, you know, and how we might quantify that, you know, that aha moment, that light bulb goes off and they're like, okay, I want that. And so that's the first step, is saying, okay, I want to measure this. I don't have data today. And so I need to partner with a company or a vendor to do that. And so once they have visibility, you know, then it becomes a broader conversation. So we asked earlier, like, what do we do with that data? How do we guide influence, right? How do we create those conversations between now our security team and the leaders? You know, that's when we start thinking about operationalizing it. And, you know, that takes a different approach for different organizations. Most of the time, it's best if it can be embedded into, you know, I guess the nature of this conversation today, a risk management program or a metrics program or something that you're already running. So if your leadership is already looking at, you know, a specific dashboard all the time, well, why are we not embedding our human risk metrics and our human risk insights into that same dashboard? If we're having leadership conversations, you know, in a monthly, quarterly basis, well, let's bring the human risk factors and those conversations, those dashboards to the table. And so if we're running another example, and I love that I'm seeing more and more organizations start doing this, but the BSIL role, the Business Information Security Officer, these people are literally charged. Their goal is to connect security to the business. Well, what better way than to talk about the human aspect, right? Because that's where the other business leaders are focused. So, you know, I think it's there can definitely be some areas that are semi cookie cutter. You know, our job and our goal was to create a program and a platform that then could be adapted to each person's environment. But you really need to figure out a way to start building the data, the metrics, and the conversation into some of the processes that you already have for it to be the most successful. There's a lot more there. I know, I could, again, talk about this all day, but hopefully that answered your question.
Yeah. And I think that really wraps up where I was heading. My co-host did a fabulous job. Like, where do you start? Where are the recommendations? Where is the guidance come from? It's kind of around Gartner security behavior and culture program is kind of the guide, I think, Ashley, that people are going to use in the interim until this market gets a little more well-defined, isn't it?
Yeah. So I would say the two pieces, and I mentioned them earlier, the SBCP, that's the what, Like, what does a program look like, a successful program look like? And then Gartner overlaid their pipe framework, and that's the how. That's the how do we start operationalizing it? What things do we need to enable? How do we develop influence to actually be able to run a successful SBCP program? And so I think those two things work hand in hand. So I definitely would recommend checking out both. Living Security has come out with our maturity model, which brings in a lot of the same pieces. And then it just puts them in a different kind of construct of, you know, how do we move on culture? How do we move on technology? And so it shows you sort of like a step-by-step guide along the way. And then you've seen others as well. You know, Forrester has some guidance out there. So again, emerging category. And so there's going to be, you know, a lot of conversations happening. I think that the great news is that if you look at the maturity model or the pipe framework or the SBCP, or if you look at Forrester's Wave or any of these other material, we're all talking about the same thing. And so that tells me, look, we're all on the right track. And so, you know, I think the more people that are out there, the more organizations that adopt this, like, we're going to just see a flywheel and exponential acceleration where we get to that 80% plus in the market that have a solution like this.
Awesome. Ashley, thank you so much for joining us on Business Security Weekly.
Thanks, Matt.
If you want to add the human to your risk management program, please visit securityweekly.com/livingsecurity to learn how. We're going to take a quick break and then cover the leadership and communications articles this week.